You're listening to Leaders Last. Leaders Last. With your host, Dr. David Robertson.
All right, welcome back to another edition of Leaders Last. I'm your host, Dr. David Robertson. Thanks so much for being a part of the program. Today we're going to talk about the paradoxical nature of tribalism. You know, it's funny because as leaders, we need to understand the utility of tribalism while also resisting its inherent negatives. That's not easy for most to do. Well, tribalism is a multifaceted concept in leadership and really social dynamics, and it can either enhance or hinder a leader's effectiveness. And to navigate this, leaders need to carefully consider their alignment with various groups and the nature of these affiliations and the values that guide their actions. In essence, leaders are really faced with about three options. Option A is just joining a group without much thought and allowing that group to dictate your thoughts and actions. And in today's world, we see that quite a bit, but this approach can be challenging for a leader in a lot of ways because it risks subsuming their individuality and critical thinking skills under the influence of the group. And leaders who follow this path usually prioritize group consensus over individual thought, which of course can lead to decisions and actions that don't necessarily align with their core values and vision. Well, option B entails valuing the thoughts and philosophies of groups, the groups you choose, based on their merit and adopting your existence, really, to match that group's criteria. We see this a lot as well. This approach is a little bit more flexible, and I agree with that, but it still carries a lot of risks. Leaders tend to compromise their core principles and values when they do this, and this is all in an effort to align themselves with a group's agenda, right? So basically, you'll see a group, you like what they're doing, maybe you have a general idea of kind of where they're going, maybe it's an inclusion situation where maybe your friends are involved with it or people you look up to are involved with it. So you try to conform to this group. But this is a problem for a lot of different reasons. For one, it results in a lack of authenticity. And basically, leaders become chameleons who really are sort of adapting to their various groups without maintaining a strong sense of self. And that's a problem. So then there's option C, which encourages you to value your own thoughts and philosophies and then shape your existence and affiliations based on thoroughly examined personal beliefs and convictions. This is an ideal choice for leaders who, well, for a lot of different reasons, but especially for those seeking a lasting impact and to maintain authenticity. This approach centers around maintaining individual agency, critical thinking, and unwavering commitment to your personal vision and values. Well, leaders who choose option C prioritize their own core beliefs and convictions above group pressures, and this is critically important. They recognize the importance of independent thought, visionary leadership, and the role of ideas and principles in guiding your actions. Leaders like this are less swayed by the allure of titles or the superficial aspects of group affiliations. And they're also more likely to inspire and motivate others towards a vision rather than a group. Moreover, in pursuing option C, leaders carefully select the groups they align themselves with, which ensures that these affiliations resonate with their vision and values. And this is why this is so important. You'll notice that the difference between these three is whether or not the leader actually pays any attention to their own values and convictions. And when you choose option C, this reinforces your leadership by surrounding yourself with a supportive group that shares those objectives and those values, which of course propels you and the group toward common goals. Option C encapsulates the essence of effective leadership. We're talking about a balanced approach between maintaining individual agency and guiding and inspiring others. But this actually requires a lot of context. It's not as simple as saying, well, yeah, trust your values and convictions and run with it. One of the critical aspects of groups is that they provide individuals with a sense of belonging and identity. And this is absolutely important. People naturally seek to connect with others who share similar beliefs and goals, and groups are a means through which this connection is established. And this is a good thing. Whether it's a group formed around religious faith or professional field or a hobby or whatever, these groups give individuals a sense of community and really a platform to express their individuality within the collective identity. Of course, groups often serve a specific purpose, and these purposes can vary wildly, right? So you could have a group of constitutionalists that unite to protect a particular right, or a group of gamers who come together to play a video game, right? In both cases, the group exists to pursue a particular cause or interest. And within these groups, individuals can contribute their skills, ideas, and perspectives, ultimately enhancing the overall effectiveness of the group in achieving its goal. And you can see this in organizations, right? A banking institution or a financial institution is all about preserving capital and lending and, you know, different services of that nature. Well, everybody in that group is sort of geared towards that same vision. But it's important to note that individuals can belong to multiple groups simultaneously. For example, you can be a member of a financial institution, but also a member of a gaming community. But if you're a leader, you're going to choose your group strategically. These affiliations are not going to define you or limit you, but rather enrich your life by allowing yourself to engage with diverse ideas and experiences. However, this is both a vital clue and a warning for leaders. In leadership, one of the most common pitfalls is the blind trust placed in titles and group affiliations. It's very common. All too often, leaders are swayed by the allure of prestigious designations or the familiarity and social pressures of belonging to a particular group. However, a more enlightened approach to leadership suggests that the focus should be on the underlying ideas, values, and principles rather than the superficial trappings of titles, pressures, or the allure of groups. Forward-thinking and visionary leaders understand that the essence of effective leadership lies not in the titles or affiliations they hold, but in the substance of their beliefs and the principles they uphold. In essence, it's not the fancy designation that makes the leader, but the ideas, wisdom, and strategies they bring to the table. Effective leadership hinges on inspiring and guiding others through a compelling vision, transcending the limitations of titles and superficial associations. And this is where people get it mixed up. Because a lot of times we get into leadership positions, or we're allured by being a part of a certain group. My advice is to select the groups that you are a part of carefully. Leaders have to choose a group that resonates with your vision and aligns with your core values. And if you're doing it right, this carefully selected group can be a source of support and reinforcement for your mission. Now, when we talk about selecting a group that shares your vision and values, you have to understand that you have to really know your vision and values first. And when you have this group, well, you get a sense of unity and collective purpose, and that can be a great thing. And this strengthens your resolve and creates a sense of common direction within the group. That's fantastic. Of course, in doing so, leaders ensure that their energy and efforts are channeled toward a shared objective rather than being diluted by group conflicts or misalignment. But the warning here is that groups evolve. And this point is a critical warning that leaders have to continually evaluate the position and direction of the groups that they have chosen. Now, the core principle, I guess the point I'm trying to get at, is that you need to maintain individual agency while guiding and inspiring others. But this duality is essential for effective leadership, and it's really the cornerstone of a successful leader-follower relationship. But again, it's not so simple. At the heart of leadership is individual agency, the capacity for you to act independently and make effective and strategic choices. A good leader recognizes that fostering individual agency within their group while avoiding groupthink is crucial. But there you go. When we get into a group dynamic, we risk groupthink. So we have to empower our team members to take ownership of their tasks, make decisions, and develop their skills. And by doing so, we cultivate a sense of responsibility and accountability while encouraging creativity and innovation within the team. So really what we're talking about here is a sense of autonomy. But again, not so simple. Leadership isn't solely about autonomy. It involves guiding and inspiring and providing a sense of direction to the group. So it's this weird little line that we have to dance. So we're preserving individual agency, but we're also creating a supportive environment that fosters collaboration and shared goals. It's a balancing act. But balancing individual agency and leadership is a sign of an adept leader. It's a testament to your capacity to lead by example, respect your team's autonomy, and offer guidance when necessary. But in doing so, you create a harmonious leadership dynamic where individuals can flourish, the group can also thrive, and collective goals can be achieved. At the same time, we have to understand that tribalism is really a deeply ingrained aspect of human nature, and it can foster a sense of belonging and cooperation within a group, while also posing a significant challenge to collaboration between different groups or tribes. Our world is increasingly interconnected and really reliant on cooperation, so it's crucial to understand how tribalism can act as a double-edged sword, sometimes preventing productive collaboration across tribal lines. So it becomes essential to emphasize the importance of shared ideas or common goals to transcend the boundaries of tribal identities. And when you do this, you actually open the door for allies. So again, tribalism is this instinctive human tendency to form groups based on shared cultural, ethnic, or ideological affinities. And when you're a part of these groups, yes, you're going to promote a sense of unity. But the thing is, when we do this, when this occurs, this often leads to an us versus them mentality, where individuals view members of other tribes as outsiders or even adversaries. This can manifest as distrust, bias, and a reluctance to work with those from different tribes. And the sad truth is that these tribal identities can become obstacles to effective collaboration because they can lead to misunderstandings and conflicts that hinder progress. So how do we overcome that? Well, again, that's the idea or vision. The idea and vision have to supersede the tribe or the identity. So we focus on shared ideas or common goals because this provides a means to overcome the limitations of tribalism. When individuals and groups come together around a shared vision or purpose or objective, it transcends tribal identities and creates common ground for cooperation. The utility of this fact cannot be overstated. The point is that the power of shared ideas or goals lies in the ability, in your ability, to unite individuals across tribal lines, encouraging them to set aside differences and work together for a greater good. And it doesn't matter if we're talking about siloed organizations or, you know, national politics or international politics. And when you look around, you'll find that collaboration across tribal identities is increasingly essential. But by recognizing the influence of tribalism and emphasizing shared ideas and goals, society, your organization, doesn't matter, we can bridge divides and harness the collective potential of diverse groups. And this shift in perspective promotes collaboration and offers a path towards a more interconnected and really harmonious future where shared objectives takes precedence over tribal affiliations. But again, this utility of tribalism and groups and shared vision, it's paradoxical because it can lead to isolationism and a lack of cooperation among the various tribes. Hence, once again, and I cannot stress this enough, the vision or goal must be more pronounced and always the central focus. But you could think about it in your own life, right? Are you more inspired by a particular group or what that group stands for? One key aspect of this idea is that it highlights the power of purpose. We need to understand that people are usually more inspired by the underlying ideal or goal rather than the tribe itself. And this is a fascinating perspective in human motivation and behavior, because while tribal affiliations and group identities, they play a significant role throughout history. It's increasingly evident that individuals, especially these days, are drawn to movements and causes and ideologies because of the principles and objectives they represent rather than just being a part of a specific group. But it's also a fantastic tool that leaders can utilize. Again, it goes back to the aspect of the power of purpose. People are more likely to invest their time, energy, and resources in something they believe in passionately. So our job as leaders is to really kind of give a reason to be passionate about the ideas or the visions that we share. And this is particularly evident in social and political movements where individuals rally behind a cause, not simply because they identify with a particular group, but because they're deeply committed to the ideas and objectives that the movement represents. Now, granted, sometimes these movements provide reasons that are a little contorted. But either way, the point remains. People are inspired by that, and they're willing to dedicate their time, energy, and effort to that idea. Of course, this also suggests that a cause's strength can transcend traditional tribalism boundaries and really unite people from diverse backgrounds and affiliations. But I also think, in a lot of ways, that this shift really kind of highlights and maybe emphasizes the importance of critical thinking in an individual agency. And I also think that it's important for us to really hone and refine the ideas and visions that we profess. Because here's the thing, easy access to information and really global connectivity allows people the opportunity to explore a wide range of ideas and perspectives. People can independently evaluate the merits of different causes and align themselves with the causes that they find most meaningful. And this autonomy in decision-making really allows for a variety of ideas and goals that aren't really confined to narrow tribal constraints. Of course, I think it's probably important to recognize that the relationship between ideas and tribes is not entirely binary. A lot of movements and causes evolve into tribes or communities of like-minded individuals who share common values and objectives. And these communities play a crucial role in fostering collaboration, support, and a sense of belonging among individuals inspired by the same ideas or goals. And this is to say that you're going to have an idea, you're going to present an idea and a vision, and people are going to like it. People are going to come together for that, which of course will result in a tribe of its own. The problem is that tribalism can stifle accuracy. Accuracy is a fundamental aspect of, well, human cognition and inquiry. But I think that really accuracy transcends the boundaries of any specific group or tribe. As I often say, accuracy has no tribe. It's a universal concept that underpins the pursuit of knowledge and understanding. It doesn't matter if we're talking about science or academia or just your everyday decision making. Accuracy will give you better results. However, an interesting aspect of accuracy is that while it's not inherently tied to a specific tribe, some groups or communities are going to place a higher emphasis on it than others. And this is really important for us to understand if we're going to be joining a group. Are we being contorted? Are we getting full transparency? Are they being accurate? Or are they kind of involved in, I don't know, manipulation? So while you're going to have some that completely commit to accuracy, some are going to completely omit accuracy for the sake of their agendas. But accuracy is paramount if outcomes matter. It's the scientific method, right? Practiced across the globe, but this demands rigorous attention to detail, verification, dissenting ideas, but also stress testing those ideas and then peer review to ensure that the knowledge produced is as accurate as possible. If you have accurate information and you're making decisions based on accurate information, you're going to get better outcomes. Leaders need to learn how to identify accuracy and then adhere to it. Like quality journalists, leaders have to understand the importance of fact-checking and corroborating sources and providing and consuming accurate information. Of course, there's another element to consider here, partial accuracy, and this is dangerous. For example, different political parties or movements can emphasize accuracy to various degrees. But the thing is, and we all know this, in certain instances, some are going to prioritize rigorous fact-checking and data-driven decision-making, while others prioritize emotional appeals and ideology over empirical accuracy. And this truth illustrates that accuracy can vary. And my point is that it's not a universal value within tribes, but a group's specific goals and priorities can influence its importance. And I share this because we have to understand that tribalism is a complex and often paradoxical social phenomenon that's deeply ingrained in the human experience. In other words, we gravitate towards it despite inaccuracy or contortion. And sometimes we will get involved despite knowing that something is contorted or inaccurate. Right? I call it the false choice. We'll join because some of it aligns, even though some of it doesn't. Right? So on the one hand, tribalism can be a powerful force that fosters a sense of belonging, unity, and collaboration among individuals. And this is really important for leaders to understand, because it's an intrinsic part of human nature to seek out connections with like-minded individuals. Right? Because when we have this, we can get emotional support. We get a shared sense of purpose and really an overall sense of security. And when harnessed positively, tribalism can lead to cohesive communities and a powerful sense of identity. And in such cases, it acts as really a glue that binds people together, which fosters mutual understanding and empathy among group members. However, the paradox of tribalism becomes apparent when this natural inclination takes a darker turn. Because sure, tribalism can promote collaboration within a group. However, it often does so at the expense of creating divisions between different groups. Again, it's the us versus them mentality, which can lead to prejudice, discrimination, and conflict. Historically, countless conflicts, from wars to social and political divisions, have been fueled by tribalism. And what you need to understand is that when groups become too insular and exclusive, they can alienate those who quote-unquote don't belong to those tribes, which of course exacerbates divisions. So again, tribalism has utility, strong utility, but it also has a darker side, and leaders need to understand how to deploy this, how to navigate it, and really kind of how to resist the negatives. In other words, I think a critical component of leadership is to recognize the dual nature of tribalism and really its potential for both positive and negative outcomes, because it can get away from you really fast. Of course, it's also important to understand what allows us to use it as a tool while, again, guarding against its potential negatives. But in order to do that, you have to acknowledge this paradox, because doing so allows you to use tribalism as a tool for good, such as fostering a sense of belonging and collaboration, but also working to mitigate divisive tendencies. So we want to emphasize shared values and common goals, but we also want to bridge the gaps and reduce conflicts. So yes, it is possible to embrace the positive aspects of tribalism while actively addressing its divisive potential. But again, we have to understand both sides. And to understand this concept, we have to examine effective team building. Effective team building is a fundamental aspect of leadership, regardless of the specific group or tribe being formed, whether in a corporate setting, nonprofit organization, social group, political group, project team. Doesn't matter. Leaders have to be adept at fostering cohesion and collaboration among team members. So if we want to build a strong team, we got to focus on a few key elements. So first and foremost, we got to understand that team building starts with the leader's vision and values. Again, we go back to that. That's got to be the central focus. You got to have a clear and compelling vision that inspires team members. And this vision is going to serve as a guiding light for the team, which of course is going to align their efforts towards that common objective. But your values also play a crucial role because they set the tone for the team's culture and behavior. So you have to know that. You have to share that. And more importantly, you have to live that. Because when the team members see their leader embodying and upholding those values, it creates a sense of trust and respect within the team, and it also kind of gives motivation to follow suit. Of course, communication is another cornerstone of effective team building, but that kind of goes back to, you know, sharing the values, communicating the values, communicating the vision, but also too, accuracy. Of course, we want to be open and transparent, but we also have to encourage an environment where team members feel comfortable sharing their ideas. And I don't want to say safe environment. I want to say emboldened environment, to have those tough conversations, even against you, where they're telling you you're messing up. The goal here is that we want to exchange information to help in problem solving, but also creating a sense of inclusivity and participation. course, collaboration, delegation, these are key aspects of team building as well. Recognition, feedback, of course. Conflict resolution is another skill that leaders have to possess. All of these things we have to work on repeatedly and every day, but they all have to be vision focused. And we have to understand too that team building is an ongoing process that requires consistent effort and attention. It's not something you do on Friday with trust falls and pizza. I mean, we have to regularly assess our progress, address challenges that arise, and adapt to the various things that are being thrust upon us, which also means that we have to adapt our approach and ensure that the team remains cohesive and aligned with the overarching vision and goal. But in the context of tribalism, I mean, we got to look at effective team building as an extension of kind of what our efforts are. This is what allows us to bridge gaps between different tribes and groups. And of course, this is achieved by emphasizing common objectives, creating opportunities for intergroup communication, and promoting a culture of mutual respect. But again, I cannot stress it enough, the paradox of tribalism. It underscores the complexity of human social dynamics and the challenge of effective leadership. And again, while tribal affiliations can foster a sense of belonging and collaboration, they can also lead to division and conflict. Leaders can navigate this by focusing on shared ideas and goals. And this is going to foster a sense of individual agency. And of course, we've got to emphasize effective team building to create cohesive and collaborative groups. If you do it this way, you can harness the positive aspects of tribalism while actively addressing its potential negatives. Yeah, so that's a lot to take in, right? But that's leadership. It's not as easy as your LinkedIn feed might have you believe. But at the end of the day, I'll say this. Just remember, leaders need to understand the utility of tribes, but also be aware of the dangers, right? The 20% real leaders, they're inspired by or create the underlying idea or goal rather than the tribe itself. Or actually, you could look at it this way. A tribe needs loyal individuals, but often individuals find themselves loyal to the tribe without receiving the same loyalty in return. Therefore, it's often wiser to redirect your loyalty toward an idea or vision. And if you're vision-focused, if you're really kind of loyal to the idea, you foster a sense of purpose that goes beyond tribal limitations, which of course makes your loyalty more meaningful, less vulnerable, and longer lasting. All right, friends, that does it for this one. Hit those buttons. I would appreciate it. Until next time, take care.